going to discuss the technology components that we have been only peripherally noting down. So primarily our concern will be the storage devices, the processing devices or the processors or CPUs. Some of the storage devices are called peripheral devices, like the disk and the tape and the mouse and the keyboard and the monitor and such things. We'll not spend too much time on discussion of peripheral devices now, although I'll give you references later so that you can look up the peripheral device. The most important peripheral device, which is not really a peripheral, is the storage device or the disk, because in information systems, much of our information resides in disks. So we shall be looking at the disks in a bit more depth. We shall also very quickly look at the storage hierarchy that a computer system presents. And of course, whatever information you store in whichever portion of the hierarchy, it has to be processed. So we need to understand a little bit more about the processing capabilities of a computer and what does it mean to us in terms of information processing capability. Because a computer processor does basic instruction execution at a certain phenomenally fast rate, billions of instructions per second kind of thing. But we are worried about how our information is processed that is relevant to us, the business information, and how do you translate or correlate the information processing requirements of our kind with the computer's innate ability to process information. So in short, we are going to look into inside the computer now and see what exactly does it hold for us. Although we'll be discussing technicalities which pertain to, you may call, computer architecture, something like that, our emphasis is not to understand, most certainly not the electronics of the computers, but also not too much about the intricacies internally, but what impact do these technologies have in terms of information processing. So in the first session, we'll discuss the storage device, mostly the disk. And in the second session, we'll discuss the main memory and the processor architecture, which together make the computer's box. So firstly, any storage of information, how do you classify? The storage could be a variety of kinds. So you can classify it based on the speed with which data can be accessed. Data is stored somewhere, and how quickly can you access that data? And then cost of storing the data per unit of data. And finally, the reliability. How reliable is the storage? Will the data be lost if power fails or if the system crashes? What happens if the storage device fails, the physical device failure? Because in an information system, you cannot afford to lose data. So before continuing with this discussion, let me ask you some questions from your knowledge of common information storage that you and I come across. Look at our physical library. We have books stored there. Okay. With what speed can you access a book? So you are locating, let's say, a book on databases. So you go to the library. So what is your search mechanism? There are what, about more than a lakh of books, right? 100,000, 200,000, 300,000, whatever be the number. So surely you don't start searching from rack A and rack B and rack C. So what do? Yeah, so you have a classification number or an accession number. How would that help? The accession number will actually point to a particular rack or a place where that book is. But the point is, you have to know the accession number. Let's say you know that there is a book by Kotz, Silberschatz and Sudarshan in database. You don't mug up the accession number as IBN 147315 or whatever. How do you find that? So you do a search. And you do a search on what? On a catalog. So basically you have In the old style libraries, you will have card decks. Modern computerized library, you can do a search on the computer. But if you have a card deck, usually you will search the cards by title or by author. And once you identify a particular book, you find the accession number, you find the place. And then you do what? Then you go physically to that rack, and then you take that book out. So without this indexing mechanism, you will agree that it will be impossible nearly to search a book. I mean, you'll be only searching the book throughout the semester. If you take, let's say, 15 seconds to take out one book and see whether that's the book you want or not, you can divide 3 lakhs by 15 seconds and find out the number of seconds required and number of hours. It's impossible. Essentially, then indexing is a key thing, whichever be the storage mechanism. How do you calculate the cost per unit of data in case of physical storage of books? There are two things now here. The physical book itself occupies a place in the library rack. So the total number of racks plus the cost of the building in which the racks are housed and the total number of books, that will give you on an average storage cost per book is so much. There is a capital investment in that building and racks, and there is a operational expenditure on running the library. So if you apportion that entire thing for the operational cost for the, let's say, just storage, you can approximately get so much money it will cost. So originally, the cost of the book itself is a cost. Consider information searching nearer home. Each one of you would have multiple notebooks in which you will take notes or something. You'll have notebooks belonging to, let's say, a previous semester, and you would have recorded something somewhere. So have you calculated the cost of storing, let's say, one notebook full of information in terms of bytes? How many bytes can you write in a notebook? Take one byte to be one character, counting blanks. On one page, how many bytes can be written? How many characters? Nobody has done that kind of calculation. So that is the cost per unit of data. What is the speed with which data can be accessed? Imagine that you have notes for this session taken on one of the notebooks. And you have, let's say, 10 such notebooks. And you have to appear for a surprise quiz or something like that, and you are searching or an exam. So first you'll have to identify that particular notebook which contains this. So how long it may take? Only 10 notebooks. In the worst case, you do a serial search. In about a minute's time, you will be able to access that notebook. Within that notebook, how will you find out where is the material for this session? Or if it is not this session, but on a particular keyword you are searching, like schema design or something, how will you find out within a notebook? Flip pages. Please remember that very rarely do we organize our own notebook with indexes. Although many of the notebooks provide for that first page index, but we do not write, you know, this is the topic, this is the page number, this is the topic, this is the page number. That is because we can quickly skim through the pages and figure that out. But what is the time that is actually required? Suppose you want to locate, say, information about normal forms in your hostel room. So about a minute to search for the right notebook, and another half a minute or 1 minute to go to that particular topic. So about 2 minutes time. Is that fair judgment? Okay. What is the reliability? There is no power failure for notebooks, but I may lose my notebook. Okay. Or there might be fire in my room, and all notebooks may be burned. So the data loss, that we can call it a system crash. System crash means, or book is just lost, or it's soiled. It falls into a bucket of water. Or I remember one notebook was put on a bicycle carrier by a friend of mine. This happened 30 years ago. And when he came out, there was no notebook on the bicycle. A cow was eating that notebook. So we jokingly told him that his notes are liked even by the cow. But he said, what about me? My notes are gone. So all kinds of funny things can happen in life. How do you safeguard against them? Notebook is not a very good example because there is a natural safeguard. My friend's notebook. So since there are typically 30, 40 students attending a class, if I lose my notes, I can always depend upon somebody else's notes. If nobody has the notes available, there is a textbook on the basis of which I can sort of reconstruct them. So you solve the problem of data loss in real life by ensuring redundancy. What if there is no redundancy somewhere? Your identity card, for example. If you lose your identity card, take the case of even IIT Bombay, you lose your identity card. So what happens, the immediate implication, if you are not well, you go to the hospital, they may throw you out. If you want to go into the lab and suppose the watchman asks for identity card, you can't get in. You need an identity card. But identity card can be replicated because the original identity card's information is maintained somewhere else as a backup. So from that backup, your identity card can be restored. It's one piece of information. In general, you will then agree that if I want to characterize the storage, I must worry about the speed with which I can access data, the cost of storing that data, and the possibility of loss of data. And ideally, what I would like, ideally, the speed with which I can access the data should be instantaneous. Ideally, the cost per unit of data should be minuscule. And ideally, I should have an arrangement such that my data is never lost. I can always resurrect it. Of course, if the original copy is lost, I understand that there will be some time I will have to spend in resurrecting. We saw that when, in case of a disk crash, how do you recover using log records and so on and so forth. It is in the context of these three questions that we shall examine the storage hierarchy inside the computer. Please understand that as far as the computer and its storage and peripheral devices are concerned, the computer is not worried about whether your data is about roll number and marks of students or whether it is your account number and balance. It doesn't care. The computer recognizes information storage as series of bits, zeros and ones, organized in a certain way. And the computer technology will worry about the accessing of those bits or bytes. So no interpretation is assumed. Interpretation is your problem. But accessing the required data, at what speed can you do that? What is the cost of storing that data, bits and bytes? And in case something happens to the storage, what is the way in which you can recover that data? We have to now map the bits and bytes into our meaningful information and figure out how much it will take for us to access the data, cost of data, etc. This is just the background. First, in terms of computer storage, we discriminate between volatile storage and non-volatile storage. Since the computer technology is electronics, we speak of electronic storage as volatile storage if the contents are lost when power is switched off. Invariably, the main memory of any computer system falls under this category. It's a volatile storage. You switch off the machine, the contents are lost. You switch it on again, the contents are non-predictable. Unless you push something into that memory, again the memory contains meaningless things. Clearly, the volatile storage is not suitable for our information processing needs from a storage perspective, long-term storage. The non-volatile storage is one where the contents will persist even though the power goes off. This will include secondary and tertiary storage as well as what is called battery backed up main memory. So as I said, main memory is something which is definitely volatile storage. So this is called primary memory. The secondary and tertiary memory are pieces of storage which are non-volatile. So in case the main memory contents are lost, you will always use that secondary or tertiary memory from which you can get the data back into the main memory. Sometimes you do require main memory itself to continue to contain what you want, what you needed, in which case you will provide a separate battery backup. So even if the main power is lost, the battery backup continues to have the same data. And this is because the electronic memory today, essentially built of what we call flip-flops, which can store zeros and ones electronically, when the power is switched off, those flip-flops lose their state. So they could be zero or one. In old times, when the main memory used to be made of magnetic core, the magnetic cores, once magnetized either this way or that way, would not lose their magnetism, even if power is switched off. So the magnetic memory used to be non-volatile, but the main memory is volatile to that extent. This is the storage hierarchy. The hierarchy is actually described in order of the time that it takes to access information inside that memory. The fastest, from that perspective, is called the cache memory. The next faster is the main memory. Slower than that main memory is the flash memory. Slower than flash memory is the disk. Slower than the disk is the optical disk. And slowest are tapes. So this is the storage hierarchy. In this hierarchy, cache and main memory are volatile storage. All other hierarchy pieces are non-volatile storage. So ideally, I would like only disks or flash memory or optical disks or tapes to use. From an information system perspective, if the last four categories of the hierarchy are non-volatile, then the question naturally would be, why the hell do we use these kind of memory at all then? What's the fun in having volatile memory if I'm going to lose memory? The problem is that the way the computers are architected traditionally, the von Neumann architecture, which was originally proposed in late 40s, you always have a combination of memory and processor, memory and central processing unit, together forming a computer. And the memory, which is called the main memory, along with the CPU, would be live only if there is power. There is no power, neither the CPU nor memory is required to function. That's how the computers have been architected. So consequently, if at all you want to use computers to process your information being on non-volatile storage does not help unless that information can be brought inside the computer's memory. And computer cannot process any information on disk or anything else. Computer can process only that information which is inside the main memory. So you have to constantly bring information from non-volatile storage inside the memory, push it back, etc., etc. And that is why the cache and main memory are important. We shall see the distinction between cache and main memory later in the second session when we discuss the memory hierarchies along with the processor and look at the computer architecture. In this session, we are going to concentrate on disk, which is the mainstay of our storage systems. Here is another way of describing storage hierarchy: primary, secondary, and tertiary. I used these terms some time ago. The primary storage is the fastest media but is volatile, so that comprises of cache and main memory. The secondary storage is next level in hierarchy. It is non-volatile. It has moderately fast access time but much slower than the main memory or cache. The secondary storage is almost always called online storage. Online storage means it's something which is physically connected to the computer always. So whenever you switch on the computer, not only do processor and memory, main memory starts working, but any online storage, typically a disk, is always accessible to you. Just like in case of a PC, when you boot the PC, the operating system gets loaded, you have access to your disk drive, all directories, etc., etc. The tertiary storage is also non-volatile. It has slow access time, and it's called offline storage. Typically, a floppy drive or a CD would be a tertiary storage or a tape, because that is not ordinarily located inside them. So even if you switch on the machine, the storage is not accessible immediately unless you go open a cupboard, pull out a CD, push that CD in. Till then, it's somewhere else. it naturally has an impact on the time to access information. Some information is on CD and not on the disk. You can't access it immediately unless you go and bring out that CD and push it into your computer. So online storage, offline storage, both refer to non-volatile storage, but they differ in the access time. And primary storage is cache or main memory. These are the three categorizations. Here's a schematic diagram of a disk drive. So what you see on the right here is called the arm assembly. These are magnetic heads. You will notice that this magnetic head is seen here. But what you don't see is the magnetic head which is actually meant for the lower surface of the top disk. The lower surface of the top disk. Because that lower surface is also magnetic. Then you have another disk here. Again there is upper surface, lower surface. Another disk here. How many such disks can you have? All of these disks are put on a single spindle. There is one lacuna there, of course, that all the disks will rotate exactly at the same speed. There is no difference. Secondly, now you can't just say go to track number so and so and sector number so and so, because now there is disk number also. How do you identify the disk number? The disk itself has two surfaces. So you may call disk 1, surface 1, disk 1, surface 2, disk 2, surface 1, disk 2, surface 2, etc. Alternately, because there is a magnetic head on each surface, you may simply number the heads. Head 1, head 2, head 3, head 4, head 5, head 6, head 7, as many heads that you have. And that will give you exactly which disk you want to read. The problem with this arrangement is that suppose I want to read, let's say, something from track 5 on the first disk, and then after that track 28 on the second disk. Now when I'm reading track 5 on the first disk, all the other heads are also exactly on the track 5 of the corresponding disk. It makes much more sense then that when I write information, rather than writing it or reading it in arbitrary track numbers and head numbers, suppose I say that I will read on a given track on all the disks, or I will write on all the disks of the same track. What will this save from the reading writing time? The movement of head across the tracks. Because once a particular head is positioned on, say, fifth track, all other heads are also positioned on the fifth track of the respective disk surface. Okay. Secondly, in a single rotation of the disk, all the heads which can read and write independently can be writing simultaneously. Consequently, I get a lot of parallelism. So if I have, let us say, five disks will mean how many surfaces? 10 surfaces. And let's say certain capacity x bytes of a track, then I can write 10x bytes in a single rotation on that track. Consequently, all such simultaneously writable single track can be assumed to form what is known as a cylinder. So if you take, those of you who have done engineering drawing can imagine that if you take a cross section of all the disks, you see a cylinder there. Okay. So this cylinder, this is the kind of cylinder that you have. How many surfaces does the cylinder have? This is the first surface, second below this, third, fourth below this, fifth, sixth, etc. If you have five disks, a cylinder has 10 sort of tracks inside it. Okay. So now the tracks are, you are now talking about a track T here. However, there is a surface 1, surface 2, surface 3, surface 4, etc. And it makes sense to read or write one cylinder full of information. Because once you move the magnetic arm on top of a particular track, all the tracks within that cylinder are aligned with the corresponding arms. So consequently, you can read or write information very fast. This is exactly how a disk drive works. In the very early days of computers, when such disk packs were made, these arms could withdraw back and this entire spindle with its cylinders could be taken out. So So these were called actually removable disc packs. Just to give you some idea of the cost, the first online disc pack that we had was on a machine called EC1030, which we got in 1974 in IIT. In late 60s, these were introduced by IBM mainframe machines. The capacity of a disk pack was, there were four disks. The capacity of a disk pack was 7.25 megabytes. Find it laughable, but that was a very large storage, online storage. 7.25 megabytes was the storage. The disk pack used to be very heavy. If I lifted it, it would take some. The disk drive itself was roughly the size of this table. And the disk drive cost was 5 lakh rupees. And the cost of a disk pack was 56,000 rupees. 7.25 megabytes. So you put it inside, and that was the early disk storage. Okay. Most of the storage used to be on magnetic tapes, but magnetic tapes were sequential devices, as we shall see. The point is that even though those devices were costly that day, they were preferred for information processing because they permitted direct access. And we shall be spending some time on what it means of direct access in terms of our information access. Is this mechanism clear? Anybody has any doubt on this mechanism? So you basically move the arms up and down on this, and then as it recites on a particular track, you can read or write on all tracks of the so-called hypothetical cylinder that is formed by the same track number on each of the surfaces. The disks are all tied to this spindle. When the spindle rotates, all disks move simultaneously. So if this disk is rotating, this is also rotating, this is also rotating. All disks rotate exactly. They are like a rigid mechanical combination.
Simultaneously, you cannot access information on the other side, means one in this side?
No, because there are two different arms. This is one arm and this is also another arm. So this arm is accessing information from the magnetic coating on the top surface. This arm is accessing information from the magnetic coating on the bottom surface. So both surfaces are accessible. And there is an electronic mechanism to read or write independently from each magnetic head. So if there are 10 magnetic heads, simultaneously 10 reads or writes can happen. You must appreciate why this is possible. The electronic speed with which the bits and bytes can pass between the magnetic heads and the inside computer are tremendously fast. As opposed to that, the movement of the disk is so slow that even if I read all of these simultaneously, I am not going to have any problem buffering that entire data, pushing it in, or collecting large amount of data from computer and separating it out. So that's not a problem, as we shall see. So all that is simultaneously accessible. What is not simultaneously doable is I cannot be reading from track 5 using this arm, and I cannot be reading on track 7 using this arm. If I am reading track 5 from this surface, all arms are exactly positioned on track 5 only. These arms don't move independent of each other. There is a head assembly, that arm assembly. The entire set of arms move forward or back. So that's the limitation. And that's the reason why we formed this concept of a cylinder. Otherwise, the notion of a cylinder was not there. Is that clear? Any question?
But can we have anti-clockwise?
You can have anti-clockwise or clockwise, but the way it is designed is it rotates only in one direction.
So
is
the time
you cannot. Try to imagine something moving at, say, 1000 RPM. And just because you are somewhere away, you say, now rotate anti-clockwise. How long will it take to stop that disk rotation and restart it? Okay. You are apparently not connected with mechanical engineering. Or you are? Good. Because if you were, I would seriously doubt your degree. There is an inertia, physical inertia of movement. And it is therefore, see, the disks, when they rotate, they don't stop. They keep rotating perpetually, whether you are reading or not. Because if you stop, the time required to start, it's not as if you switch it on and immediately you can start reading. You have to let the disk speed stabilize. And to stabilize that speed will require some time, at least 1 or 2 seconds. And 1 or 2 seconds is a large time. If every time you want to read or write, you shut up the desk and start again, it could be extremely painful. In terms of the speeds that you have, the rest of the mechanism, that's not tolerable. So that is the reason why disks typically move only in one direction. And all arms move like that for the simple reason that you want to amortize the cost of this motor which moves this arm forward and backward. If you wanted each arm to move separately, you could design that. But then you will have to provide a motor for each of the arm. And it will not be cost effective. So all that is connected with costing, that's all. Design wise, by the way, there have been attempts to answer this question more fairly. There have been attempts where a single disc has been made with multiple arms. So one arm here, one arm here, one arm there. And those arms could be positioned separately. So as the disc moves, you could read from multiple tracks. Or you could say, this arm will read only these sectors, this arm will read only these sectors, effectively increasing the speed of retrieval of data. But in a commoditized world, you generally standardize the complete manufacturing and operational process, and that is how it is now. Sorry? CDs are mostly single-sided. So the CD drive, if you see, it will have a single head. It won't have two heads. But there are double-sided CDs available, there are double-sided DVDs available. These are technical differences. Fundamentally, it does not matter. All that is either increasing capacity or increasing speed or both. But ultimately, the boundaries of movement will decide the speed with which you can access information. And two things that you should remember always as the most important or paramount important thing for a disk are these two, seek time and latency. As long as you can do simple arithmetic with these two quantities, you can know exactly whether this particular disk is useful for your purpose or not. As simple as that.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
So if they submit this transmission information from one head,
yes.
How do we ensure that not mix, information doesn't mix?
We don't ensure. The disk drive, the processor under the command of operating system which controls the disk file system ensures all that. So if necessary, it will not read as fast as the physical disk drive may permit. For example, suppose you have connected 400 disk drives to a single computer, 400, which is possible now. You have 400 controllers. But the computer's internal bus is not capable of handling that kind of thing. Then even though you may issue an instruction to read from all 400 disks, operating system internally will decide that it will first read from these 20, next from those 20, next from those 20. So you and I don't have to worry about it. If we were to worry at that level, we will not be building information systems. We will all be computer technologists worrying about bits and bytes and reading. The idea of the technology is to buffer the other usage from the technology relevant points. What we are discussing here is just to understand how these technologies work. But we are buffered by several layers which we shall see shortly. Yes. So coming back again, the excess time to information, whether you want to read or whether you want to write, two main components, seek time. The time to move the excess arm, okay, how much time it, and latency or rotational delay. Latency is a general term. Latency is perhaps the most important term in information processing because you have to worry about latency of moving information or accessing information. But latency is used in the context of disk drives as rotational delay, which is average half rotation. Is that very clear? Why average half rotation? Because you might have just passed that point or you might be just reaching that point. So it is zero latency or one full rotational delay latency. And seek time, of course, time to move the excess arm. Using these two simple things, you can do very reasonable computations to find out whether your requirements are met or not met. So here are some storage excess timings. Rotational speed from a floppy disk, 360 revolutions per minute. So what is the time for one rotation? It's not exactly 83.3, but I think it's 83.33333 something, right? How do you find that out? 360 rotations per minute means in 60 seconds. So 36 rotations in 1 second, that is 1000 seconds divided by 36. Is that the correct number? I think so. In 1000 seconds, there will be 6 rotations. No. Yeah, 6 rotations. So, no. How is that? Yeah, yeah. Sorry. A rotation is half the rotational speed. Not one rotation, but half rotation is the latency. Is that number correct? Can somebody cross check?
1000 by 60 is 160 and half of that.
So is this correct? Fine. 83.3 milliseconds is the time required on an average to access, to wait for the rotational delay. Wherever you have recorded that information. The average seek time is 4 milliseconds to 20 milliseconds. 20 milliseconds in case of a floppy disk, 4 milliseconds in case of a hard disk. The seek time may appear to be 5 times more, which is okay, but that is not the important thing. For a hard disk, the rotational speed is much faster. Earlier hard disk used to be 3600 RPM. Modern hard disk typically rotate at 7200 RPM. 7200 revolutions per minute, by the way, is very fast speed. That should answer your question. You know, when you are rotating something at 7200 revolutions per minute, you cannot, you know, stop it and move it the other way around. You can actually compare it with, have you played the top anytime? Bhora. Ghumaya bhora kabhi. So you spin that bhora rapidly and then it starts rotating. Now imagine having to stop it and turn the other way around. The effort itself required will be too much. So that's again coming back to saying why you keep rotating it one day. In fact, if a hard disk is at standstill, just to start rotating will require a few seconds before it stabilizes at this speed. That's why before that you generally hard disks in information systems are never stopped. You will find some laptops, you know, which you are not using laptop for quite some time, you are doing some simple editing, no disk access is made, the disk will stop. At that moment, try to save your file. So, karke some sound will come, the disk will start rotating, and it will take some time before it is saved. While the disk is rotating, you say save, it gets saved very quick. The difference is because of it. Anyway, so is this clear? The fundamental difference between floppy and hard disk is that the floppy rotates only at 360 revolutions per minute, hard disk rotates at 7200 revolutions per minute. There is another difference. The magnetic head, which is meant for a floppy drive, actually touches the floppy drive. So it actually touches that floppy drive and reads and writes. Because it touches, the friction, the mechanical friction, after some time, you can have a completely worn look. That's why the floppy goes bad very quickly. If you take the floppy out and remove that cover, you can see practically the hose. We call it a see-through floppy. You can see through it. It's nothing. Whereas on hard disk, a magnetic head never ever touches the surface. Never ever. Now that means it's a more difficult technology. The head actually floats on top of the surface. There's a few micron gap. And so beautifully organized, because at 7200, if the head was to touch it, the head will break or the surface will scratch. So that's a different technology altogether. In fact, many times when you have a major disaster with a disk, they call it head crash. That means somewhere the mechanism did not work and one head actually bungled up and touched the disk and kaput, the end of it. So that technology is different. And it is because of that it can rotate at this speed and read and write at that speed. Anyway, coming back to our original problem of time to access information, rotational speed, which is latency means half the rotational speed, and average seek time, 4 milliseconds to 20 milliseconds, these are the two key parameters. So let's try and solve a problem here. I told you can do arithmetic simply. You have a 1 gigabyte disk. You don't get 1 gigabyte disk very easily now. You get 40 gigabyte disk. So you can You can translate that appropriately. Let's imagine that that hard disk has 800 cylinders. It rotates at 7200 RPM. And let's say the average seek time is 12 milliseconds. And you have floppy disks. The capacity is 1.44 megabytes. Rotates at 360 RPM. The average seek time is 40 milliseconds. These are the parameters given. Find the time required to back up a 512 megabyte sequential file on a floppy. So imagine that 512 megabytes of a file has been written. It's half the capacity of the disk. Okay, so you can assume whichever way it is stored. You can assume it is stored on the sequential cylinders of the disk, so that easiest you can keep moving from track to track. And that's a sequential file, and you have to store it on a floppy. Obviously, 512 megabytes will not fit onto a single floppy, because the floppy capacity is 1.44 megabytes. You require multiple floppies. Now, how long will it take to back up a 512 megabyte sequential file on a floppy disk? So you have 1 gigabyte disk, and you have floppy as a backup. You want to safeguard that if the disk crashes or something goes wrong, your file is important. Let's say the file contains all your accounting transaction or medical history or whatever, important information. As far as the disk is concerned, it does not give a damn as to what is the semantics of that information. It has so many bytes, it needs to be backed up. So as information scientists, you have to work out a backup and restore scheme, you know, in case of a problem. So if this is the problem, so tell me, how long will it take? Can you do some simple arithmetic? I always claim that at least 50% of the major problems of the world can be solved by a simple arithmetic, provided you put the parameters right. I would like to know what is your answer. How many seconds, minutes, hours it might take? It's wonderful. No, more than 8 seconds, you could have also said more than 0 seconds. But 8 seconds, is it realistic? What, perhaps more than 8 seconds for writing the entire file on a floppy? Okay, very, very interesting. You're moving the floppy disk at 360 revolutions per minute. First of all, it is very obvious to you that writing on a floppy is going to be much slower than reading from a disk. So the reading speed actually does not matter, as long as it is much more than writing speed. Are you seriously suggesting that within 8 seconds I can write 356 floppies? So then 8 seconds is not the correct timing. I have to back up 512 megabytes of data. So here is a solution. First, I analyze the given data. I do look at my problem seriously. So I do look at my disk. Cylinder capacity is 1.2 gigabytes. Divided by 800, because there are 800 tracks, and that means each track is one cylinder. Okay, so at a time I can read one cylinder in one rotation, wherever I have put that heads. So the cylinder capacity is roughly 1.5 megabytes, which I say roughly is a floppy capacity. So that means this information can be copied or read in one rotation after a seek. Once I seek, I can read this much of information from the disk. It will take about 12 milliseconds average seek time, and 4.16 milliseconds is the average rotational delay, totally about 16.16 milliseconds. That means the time it takes to read from a disk one floppy full of information is 16.16 milliseconds. I need not even worry about that. That's the purpose of showing this. There are approximate calculations. For backing up 512 megabyte file, over 250 floppies would be needed. That is the first observation, because the capacity is 1.44 megabytes. Time required to write on floppy, how much is that time? Rotation takes 166.6 milliseconds. Seek time is 40 milliseconds. So one track is written in 200 milliseconds. Remember, I am not reading, I am writing. So one full rotation means I can write one track. After writing one track, I go to the next track. then next track, etc. So one track is written in 200 milliseconds. How many tracks? You assume that. The original problem did not specify. If you are alert, you would immediately ask me how many tracks. Because without it, you cannot find out how long it will take. Suppose I told you entirely one track contains 1.44 megabytes, then your entire solution is 200 milliseconds. But if there are 80 tracks, how much does that become? Time to write on one floppy is 80 into 200 milliseconds. Please note that this has nothing to do with the speed with which the information can be handled inside the main memory. This is the time physically required for that stupid floppy to write. And it is not 1.44 MB which can come in one shot and get written. Remember, while the disk is a direct access device, at one time I can write only on one track. Only when the track is fully written, then I can go to the next track, then next track. There are 80 tracks. So that means it will take 16 seconds to just write on one floppy, not even 8 seconds, 16 seconds. You took half the revolution perhaps, but you are writing one full rotation. You have to write. 16 seconds is the time to write one floppy. Now you have written that floppy. What you'll have to do now? That let's say the backup program tells you floppy is written. You'll have to take that floppy out, put some kind of a label on it, insert a new floppy inside. Is that a trivial job? Once we insert a floppy, the operating system has to recognize that a new floppy has been put in. Is that a trivial activity? Those of you who have used floppies would recognize that. Assume that it takes 2 to 4 seconds. Time for taking a floppy out, labeling, and for entry in a record log. Why? Just labeling is not sufficient. You must maintain a manual register in which say floppy number 123, 124, 125, whatever, some information. Assume that it is 10 seconds. Okay. You can, because this is human time. You can say, no, I am very efficient, so 5 seconds I will do it. Okay, 5 seconds, but some time. Non-trivial, non-zero time. What does it add up to? 16 seconds plus this time. You know, I got a very clever answer 2 batches ago. He said, sir, the moment that program says that thing is over, I'll keep the other floppy ready. Take it out and put it in. And then while it is writing, I will put labeling, etc., etc. Clever answer. So you take it out and put it in, but still operating system has to recognize that. You have to take it out, put it somewhere. So maybe 2 seconds. So don't take 10 seconds, but 2 seconds at least. 2 seconds plus 16 seconds. Ordinary mortals like me will take 10 seconds. So 16 plus 10 seconds is the time per flop. How much does it amount to? Close to 3 hours. With half a minute per floppy, 350 floppies will need 175 minutes or close to 3 hours. This is if the operation is continuous. What if one floppy gets wrongly labeled? Now imagine the human errors or machine technology. One floppy goes bad while recording. What do you do? Typically, you will not even come to know that recording has gone bad unless you try to read it. You know, when you do these kind of backups, that is the reason why backup programs don't just write. They reread and confirm that what has been written is exactly what I wanted to write. If you wanted to do that, double the time. Okay. Alternately, pay the risk. So what if a floppy does not read later? In short, what is the correct answer to this problem? The correct answer to this problem is, it is wrong to use floppies as a backup for large files. From an information perspective, information system perspective, that is the correct answer. It's not the arithmetic, but the arithmetic is so skewed that we should immediately, so now we should still do all these computations in our mind. But somebody says, now I am giving you a computer system with 1 gigabyte of disk and a floppy drive for backup. Say, thank you very much, it's not good enough. If my disk capacity is 1 gigabyte, and now I have what? 40 gigabytes, 80 gigabytes, 100 gigabytes. That is why people do not give you floppy drives anymore. They give you what? CD rewritable CDs, now rewritable DVDs. So what is the capacity of a, you can now map the same problem, the scales are different. Imagine you have 150 gigabyte disk and 760 megabyte CD-ROM and you have a writable CD. And people who have sold you that machine would have convinced you that CD can be used for backup. Now imagine that you have a 100 gigabyte file which you want to backup on CDs. So you have 120 CDs to be written. Each CD after writing you have to read to confirm that it can be read. Fortunately CDs are more reliable than floppies. But still they are CDs and you have to label each CD. So is that a correct backup strategy? It is not. Just remember that these ratios are very, very important when you talk about backup devices and things like. Although the example is centered around backup timing and so on, the fundamental fact of life is that capacities of the total disk drive, the latency and the seek time are the cardinal things by which you can decide how long it takes to access information. Let's go ahead and concentrate only now on reading and writing information meaningfully for our purposes. Okay. So for backup and restore operation, you need special solutions which exist and you can permit incremental backup. So you will very rarely put a half gigabyte file as a single file. Half gigabyte file does not fall from the sky in the first place. Okay, if it's some kind of a master file where you are adding, let's say, file of records of alumni. Now the alumni, all 33,000 of them did not fall from sky overnight. They have been accumulated. Every year we add 300 or 350. So I will consequently, I can keep backing them up every year as the backup increases. That's called an incremental backup. Just an example. But that's the kind of backup strategy in the context of information systems that you would like to derive. However, the real advantage of the disk is not for just storing the information and dumping it in the backup. The real advantage is the ability to access it very quickly. And that is why we like the notion that directly accessing data on disk is very important. Here is a thumb rule. At 7200 RPM, you can, per second, the number of input-output operations that you can conduct on a disk are about 50 blocks. We have not defined what a block is. Okay? A block is some storage. Imagine the context of the diagram that I drew, consider a sector as a block. So a sector is a portion. Okay. Now imagine that in actual practice on the disk, the information that you seek to read or write is not organized beautifully in the same cylinder within the same sector, etc. Some information is written here, some information is written there, some information is written somewhere else. Consequently, to access any piece of information, which for the time being we call a block, in order to access a block on the disk, I may have to randomly move my arm somewhere and wait for some half rotation. So this is called a random IO. Now how many random IOs can I do per second? I have said here 50. 50 blocks per second. Can you justify this 50 blocks per second? In 1 second, if I can access 50 blocks, then what is the time required to access one block? 1 second divided by 50, that is 1000 milliseconds divided by 50, which is how much? 20 milliseconds. You will realize that the average access time and the average rotational delay together could be about 20 milliseconds for some slower disk. It has improved significantly now. Imagine that 20 milliseconds has become 10 milliseconds. You can't make it faster than 10. Because there is a rotational delay. That is the killer. The access time is not much for hard disk, but rotational delay, if you want to randomly search somewhere, that rotational delay is there. So instead of 50, now you can say that the access is about 100 blocks per second. What we conclude now is very important. If we imagine that on a hard disk of a fairly large capacity, the information that is relevant to us, whether it is account information, whether it is academic information of a student, whether it is census information, whether it is insurance policy information, these information pieces are stored in blocks. And I want to randomly access a block. And I imagine that my information is spread across the disk. Then ordinarily, how many blocks can I access per second is about 100, 50 to 100. And in past 30 years, the number of blocks that can be accessed has actually moved from about 25 to 100, that's all. Electronics, on the other hand, has moved far more rapidly. So consequently, the memory speeds are extraordinarily faster as compared to disk speeds. This is about random access. Now, given 100 accesses, 100 blocks per second, how long would it take to access one required record? Suppose I want to read, let's say, one student's record, CPI. That record is how much? The roll number, name, CPI, hostel number. Take our schema. Yeah, 80, 100 byte record. Obviously, if I know the block on the disk in which that student's record is there, the time that I will require, random access, is time to read one block, which could be 1 by 50 seconds or 1 by 100 seconds, provided I know which block. How many blocks can be there? What is the notion of a block? That's an important, component of the direct access. A block is typically defined as a fixed capacity size described by the operating system, not by the disk. I will recommend that you read the Unix file system as a very interesting mechanism of indexing. It actually formats the disk, puts aside several blocks just to keep information about files, and then maintains a list of free blocks which are available. Then whenever you ask for storage, it allocates those blocks. You might edit a file and delete some portion, in which case you release some blocks. So block number 23 is released by you. Then the Unix operating system will allocate block number 23 to someone else who asked for that additional block later. So I might have a file which is recorded, let's say, in block number 1001, 1002, 1003, and then 23, because 23 became the available block. So consequently, there is no guarantee that my information will be necessarily written in sequentially contiguous blocks. Why is that important? Because sequentially contiguous blocks, at least originally when the disk was formatted, actually were on contiguous tracks or contiguous cylinders. Consequently, reading or writing would have been a bit faster. So I have to assume that my reading or writing any block will take about 1/100 of a second. Consequently, I must minimize the number of blocks that I read for any information handling. Is that clear? Imagine now if I have the data for all the library books in a disk. Remember, like the index that we mentioned, we're trying to find out. On a computer, I want to search a particular library book with its title, this, that, and the rack position. And I have the name of the library book or something. And I have stored all of these data on the disk. So how will I do that search quickly? So for that, I have constructed an example here. Here is an example of index schemes on the disk. Assume that there are records, okay? Records which I have stored. A file has records, like CPI records or employee records or what. Suppose each record has a pointer or address, like in a position in an array. So can we not prepare an index? Let's say there is a key of that record. Let's say the key is A23P415697. This is a attribute that we know. Let's say part number. This is a part number. The part number's record is stored in some block. And let's say this is the pointer to that block number. And let's say this is an 8-digit number. 8-digit number means a lot of blocks I can have. Truly modern disks have those many blocks. Supposing for each key that I have, I prepare an index table like this. then will it not be easier for me? I search this index, and in this index, I get a pointer, then I go to that pointer. To go to that pointer, I will require one block access, right? To actually, once I get the pointer, but how do I get a pointer? Because I don't know that your record is block 127, somebody else's record is block 1000 something. How will I know? So you, him, her, I will identify some key, which is roll number in your case. In this case, this is the key. So suppose I make like this, what will it mean? Where do we store this index? Suppose we store this index as a file on the disk. Okay, we store this index itself as a file on the disk. How many blocks will the file occupy? Depends on the size of the file. See, imagine I am putting together a database of all the students appearing for 12th standard in, let us say, southern states. Easily about 1.28 crore records. How many blocks will an index of 1.28 records occupy? Imagine the block size to be 512 bytes. That is one block size. Let's go back here. The key is 24 bytes. Pointer is 8 bytes. Total is 32 bytes. One entry of index is 32 bytes. How many entries I can put in a block? 128 entries. Assume there are 1.28 crore records, deliberately chosen this number. Then I will have 1 lakh blocks just for the index. So the assumption that I will quickly look up the index and then go to that block. The time required to go to that block is 1 by 100 seconds or 1 by 50 seconds. But to search that block number, I will now have to read each one of these 1 lakh records, 1 lakh blocks. How many seconds? Assuming 100 blocks per second, I have to read 1 lakh blocks. On an average, half lakh. Because I might find it somewhere half it. Can I do binary search? I can't, because I don't know where these blocks are written. Okay. So, average time required to search the index, if scanned sequentially, is, assuming 50 blocks per second read, about 17 minutes. After 17 minutes, I will get a block which contains that fellow's information. I say, now within 1 by 50th second, I get your information. Is that good? Not useful. So you see the non-trivial problem that we are talking about. Indexing something occurs to us very quickly, but indexing on the days when each block, if read or written randomly, will require 1 by 50 seconds or 1 by 100 seconds, we think it is very small a time. But if the index itself has 1 lakh entries, how will you handle that?